So, okay, so the focus of... Yes.
Can you turn the light on?
Ah, sure.
Is this better or worse? Better.
So the focus of today is the following problem, which I don't know if there is a good name for it, so let me call it the rank one vector problem. So the input is some subspace W, a subspace of R n squared, and the goal is to distinguish between the following two cases. One is the case that there is a rank one matrix, and we are going to focus for today on the symmetric case. So there is a vector such that VV transpose is in W, and the other case is that for every V and say M in W, the distance of VV transpose from M is at least epsilon. Okay? So this is the problem that we are going to be focused on solving. And the result we'll talk about, and this is work with Pavish Kotari and David Storer, that if our 3 a.m. Writing style, and hopefully it will be, we hopefully will appear in stock 17, God willing, is a 2 to the O tilde square root n algorithm for this problem. And it's based on the sum of squares. It's based on the sum of squares hierarchy, and we'll see how it goes. And I think this is kind of a natural question in its own right. So basically finding a rank one solution to a set of linear equations, I think it's, you know, somewhat natural, maybe to people like us, maybe probably not very natural for the global population, but I think it's somewhat, you know, a clean problem. But if you don't care about it, let me tell you why. If you care about quantum information theory, you might care about that. And I'll only be kind of brief about it. This is somewhat of a repetition of what we said last week, so it's also appeared in the paper, but let me somewhat just briefly sketch the connection to quantum. So basically, the one thing that people are trying to do in the context of quantum information is, you know, they have some system and they want to prove that the system has entanglement in it. So how do they do that? One thing is that, you know, this system has like two parts, and you make some measurement. So you apply some measurement to, so the, you apply some measurement to the state, and you get some very and you succeed with some probability. Let's say you succeed with probability one. Nothing is really one, but let's see, think of it as one, or so like one minus zero of one. And if this little is very little. So so you succeed, you know, you succeed with probability one, you run this thing many, many times, and you say, okay, this state passes this measurement. Now we want to say that the fact that it passes this measurement certifies that it passes this measurement certifies that the system contains entanglement in it. So what you want to do is you want to certify that for every separable non-entangled row, a trace of M row, that was the trace, is at most, say, 1 minus some epsilon. So, and what is what does it mean that the state is separable? Row is separable, that means that it's a convex combination of something that looks like U star, V star, star, or in the real case, if we are in a symmetric real case, then it's, you know, just expectation of V tensor to the 4, where V is unit vector. So you want to certify that this is the case. So generally, one problem is that we don't have an efficient algorithm to look at the measurement and say if that's the case or not, and this is kind of the best the first algorithm that beats brute force. So we really want to know how well you can do, and there are results of Haro and Montanaro. Basically saying that, you know, if you assume exponential time hypothesis, which is a reasonable assumption, the running time needs to be at least n to the omega of log n. And whether the running time, the true running time is closer to 2 to the square root n or to n to the log n, it's a super interesting problem. And at the very end of today's lecture, I'll talk about what kind of directions we could look at if we wanted to improve things further. And I think, and I think that's a great open problem. I don't know how easy or hard it might be. Yes?
I'm sorry, these two, are you saying they're...
Ah, yes, that's, yes. Why are they equivalent, morally equivalent? And then, so why are they morally equivalent? So think of this as being one, okay? So so think of W, right, so M is an n squared by n squared matrix. It's a measurement matrix, right? So it's between 0 and I. So we can think of it as a sum of lambda I, I W I, so where lambda I's are between 0 and 1, and the I W I's is the projectors to the Eigen space corresponding to lambda I. And basically, if we just define W to be W 1, or, you know, W of lambda W. Call it W of lambda I, so W of 1, like the projector to the eigenspace corresponding to the eigenvalue 1, then you see that if there is a separable state, that achieves probability 1, that means that there is a vector V. We are, let's say, in the symmetric case, there is a vector V such that all its mass is completely inside this eigenspace W. And if not, then every vector V has at least some epsilon mass outside of it. Yes, that's a good question. Yes, so that's why these problems are basically the same. And let me already say, here is an open problem of the week. Right now, so let's say open problem of the week. Handle imperfect completeness. So that would basically say, handle the case where, say, the projection is, say distinguish between this case, that, say, the project, even something like that would be interesting. Say, distinguish between the case that the projection is 99% and the projection is 1%. And I'll mention something maybe towards the end that to some extent, right now our result would basically cannot really handle the 99%. It can handle maybe 1 minus 1 over n or something like that, but not 99%. And I'll mention maybe at the end a little bit about some directions to that. To some extent, you can say that if you're familiar with some results in mathematics like van der Waarden theorem versus Semmeridis theorem, where you have like coloring versus density statements. So in some sense, you could say that we are in a situation where we have the corresponding coloring statement, but we don't have the corresponding density statement. If these things didn't make any sense to you, maybe at the very end of the lecture I'll explain it more and it will make a little bit more sense. But yeah, so this is open problem of the week. And the harder problem, I think, so open problem of the month is, you know, 2 to the n to the 1/3 algorithm. And maybe of the year is, you know, n to the poly log n algorithm. So, and I'll not talk about it too much. It's in the paper. The way if you talk to quantum, I guess particular type of quantum people, so I think there are like two families of quantum information theorists. One that, you know, come from the more quantum side, and then they call this problem, they will talk about entanglement witnesses. And these are the people that actually maybe look at actual real quantum states and want to find out if they're entanglement. And then there are like people from the more computer science side, which I think they will, define this problem is they'll ask if QMA2 is inside X. And that would be, I think, the phrasing like of the more CSE type quantum. But we are going to actually, in general, quantum mechanics is reversible, so you can't really erase information, but let's try to imagine that you could. So erase everything quantum, we forget about quantum from this point on. We're going to focus on this problem. Everything is real, symmetric, mostly because of notation. I should mention that you might think that the sum of squares inherently is only over the reals, but it's not really, because you can define sum of squares over the complex. You know, you use the fact that instead of you replace x squared by, you know, x bar being non-negative, so you can define sum of squares over the complex. So basically, everything that I'm going to say will generalize to the complex case, will also generalize to the asymmetric case. It's just a little bit more pain. Okay, so basically, the problem that I'm going to focus on is this problem over there. We are given a subspace in n square dimensional space. We want to know if it contains a rank one matrix or every rank one matrix is far from it. There is kind of an obvious 2 to the n type algorithm. You make an epsilon net over all n dimensional vectors. You just try them all and see what happens. So we're trying to do something better. It's kind of significantly better. Okay? So we have basically gone over steps 1, 2, and 3 in the plan. Okay. So now, let me describe the algorithm. Okay, so the input is this subspace of Rn squared. Again, the way when I say input is a subspace, I mean you get like some basis to the subspace. The operation, we do the following thing. We're going to let k be O tilde of square root n, some value that we'll choose later, and we're going to run SOS to get a mu over the sphere, the n minus one dimensional sphere. It's like v in Rn, where the norm of v is one, such that satisfies this constraint that vv transpose is in W. And obviously, if we don't get something like that, we can output fail. We are guaranteed by the SOS algorithm that if there was actually, if we were in the first case, then there would be an actual distribution satisfying it. In particular, there would be a pseudo distribution for any k. So if we don't get something like that, we know for sure we are not in the first case. So we can basically output second case and be done with it. Now, if we do get a pseudo distribution like that, what we want to do is find some vector, say little w, that has decent projection into such that little w, the little w transpose, has decent projection into the subspace capital W. Okay, so what we are going to do number two and this is kind of the heart of the matter, we're going to appeal to a structure theorem, which we'll describe shortly, and that structure theorem will give us we're going to get some polynomial p of degree, say at most k minus 2, such that the expectation matrix p of x, p of v, vv transpose, is roughly rank 1. What does it mean that it's roughly rank 1? So that this minus v0 transpose is less than epsilon v0 transpose. And if you think about it, it seems somewhat strange a priori. You have a distribution over rank one things. There is no reason why the expectation matrix should be rank one, right? Typically, that's not the case. But if it is the case, then we're very happy, right? We just output V0 and we just output V0. Yes?
What are
V0? So V is the distribution over V, right? So think of it, the pseudo distribution goes over V. We reweigh this pseudo distribution by P of V. And then there really exists some V0. So the structure theorem tells us that there exists some polynomial P, and such that if V0 will actually, and some V0. Actually, the way we will do it is we rescale things so that we're going to rescale things such that by a constant, so that expectation of mu PV is 1, and then V0 is just expectation of mu PV V. So
V0 is something you get out of the
structure. What?
V0 is something you get out of the
structure. Yes. Yes, so in some sense, what we, in some sense, this is simply the expectation. Maybe another way to write it is, which is actually how we are going to define it. So basically, we're going to say, if we define mu prime to be p of v mu of v, right? So define this, and the way we scaled it, mu prime is also a pseudo distribution. Then the way we can write it is that expectation of a mu prime v v transpose minus expectation of a mu prime v expectation of a mu prime v transpose is at most epsilon expectation of a mu prime v. Right, and then we can write output V0, which is just expectation over mu prime V.
So I didn't understand exactly what M was in the very first step here.
Mu.
Oh, mu.
Yes.
Oh, mu.
So,
is, okay, sorry.
Yes. So mu is a pseudo distribution of the Greek A. Yes.
Yeah, it's just because previously you called M.
Yes.
Yeah, no, okay.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. So mu is a pseudo distribution. So the Greek K pseudo distribution. So we're going to run in time n to the k roughly, and we're going to output this pseudo distribution. So the heart of the matter is this kind of structure theorem, which a priori you might think is just a little fishy in the sense that. Typically, think about it, rank one is a very non-convex thing, right? You take combination of two things that are rank one, it's going to be rank two. So if you have a distribution, a priori, you might think that it's not going to be, if it's a distribution over many rank things, if you take the expectation of it, it's not going to be rank one. But somehow the point would be that the way we want to think about it is that we're going to have this distribution be, there is going to be, like every guy in the support of the distribution is going to be, you know, a small vector, this is V0, so every V will be equal something like, you know, V will equal V0 plus V prime. Where V0 might be very, very small. This is kind of the expectation vector. But the point is that it's always in the same direction. And this V prime is going to cancel out. So basically what could happen is that, and that's what we kind of will happen, is that you're going to look at expectation of V0 plus V prime, V0 plus V prime transpose, that's going to be, you know, V0 transpose. V prime, so V0 is the expectation, V prime is the rest. And think of the rest as being much bigger than the expectation, but it has mean zero. So because it has mean zero, these cross terms cancel out, so you get expectation V prime transpose. So the point would be that maybe what we could hope is that these cancellations will be so big, so they will be so significant that that even though this is not a unit vector, even though every vector v prime is individually much bigger than v zero, when you take their average, you get something that is of a Frobenius norm much smaller than the Frobenius norm of this. Yes.
Sorry if I somehow missed this, but you say we're running SOS.
Yes.
What are we optimizing?
We're asking for SOS with constraints. So you could say one way to think about it is you're minimizing the projection to W perp of V V transpose, minimizing over V E1.
Okay.
But the minimum will be zero. So you, if the minimum is more than zero, projection of D squared, right? So this is a kind of a degree, whatever, four polynomial or something. So, but another way is the minimum will be zero. So in some sense, you the way you kind of imagine it is that you have a distribution that is supported only on vector on vectors V that satisfy V V transposes in W. Yes.
For the soundness, are you saying just check it on V zero?
So basically, what you want to say is the following: either this, you know, if this doesn't work, basically, what the structure theorem will tell us that if we find a pseudo distribution like that, we are guaranteed that V zero is going to be good. I mean, because V zero, okay. So. Let me say why is this going to be good. So let me give the analysis. So the analysis is very simple if we have this condition star. So the analysis. Okay, let's pretend that let's start by pretending that this is an actual distribution. So if it's an actual distribution, mu over V such that VV transpose is in W, then we get that expectation of VV transpose is in expectation of, then we get that expectation of P of V, VV transpose, doesn't really matter what P of V is always in W, right? It's a linear combination of things that are in W. So it's always going to be in W. And so we get, so basically what we get is that there exists some matrix W, some matrix, let's call it M in W, such that M minus V0, V0 transpose is smaller than epsilon V0, V0 transpose. Which is exactly shows that you are not in the previous case, right? So this, if it's an actual distribution, now let's suppose it's not an actual distribution; it's a pseudo distribution. What we can say is the following: so when it's a pseudo distribution, what we know is that okay? So maybe if I only add colors, let me put here like what we will say in a pseudo distribution. In a pseudo distribution, what we know, we know that expectation of this p. By the way, let me again. Okay, maybe it doesn't matter. Okay, so let's. So what we know is that expectation of a pseudo expectation of projection to W perp VV transpose squared is zero. Right? That's the condition that we have. And so, by Cauchy-Schwarz, we know that expectation of P of X, this thing is smaller than expectation of P of X. This thing is smaller than expectation of this thing squared. Expectation of P of X squared, which is zero. So basically, we can. So basically, what we can say is we can argue using Cauchy-Schwarz that you know, because this is basically always a positive polynomial and its expectation is zero, that when you hit it with any kind of polynomial, you're still going to get zero. Maybe I need to also assume this, which somehow it comes automatically. If you assume that this thing is squared is zero, this thing to the fourth is also zero. So then you bound this, the expectation of this polynomial by this times this squared, which is zero. So the bottom line is that you can argue that the projection to W perp the norm of the expectation of the projection to W perp V transpose is going to be less than the norm, and this is with pseudo expectations now. It's going to be less, or D squared is going to be less than the pseudo expectation of pi. And this is also under mu prime squared, which is going to be zero. Okay, so the bottom line is that also if you get the pseudo expectation also in the pseudo distribution case, this matrix, if you look at this matrix, pseudo expectation of under mu prime of VV transpose, it's going to be inside the subspace W.
Yes, where's the 3K concern?
Ah, because for this to make sense, okay, the structure theorem will require that. And so it will give us a degree, a polynomial of that degree, and right. So the structure theorem will tell us that it requires this degree square root n. And we'll see in the structure theorem why this comes up. Okay, so I think I made it a little bit even more complicated than it needs to be, because it's very simple, right? So the algorithm itself is kind of very simple. You basically just say that you're going to have somehow all these cancellations that you are going to have this condition that the expectation matrix is roughly rank one, and then you're just going to output the expectation matrix. And yes?
Is there a new point underneath both those expectations?
Here and here, yes. And this one, okay, and to bound this, you could say this is basically, in this case, why is this zero? The reason it's zero because expectation of this will be basically like expectation of P of V and then you could do some Cauchy Schwarz. This is, and then you could do some Cauchy Schwarz and show that it's zero. So, and again, for actual distribution, this is kind of obvious. If you have a distribution over things that are in the subspace, if you take, no matter how you reweigh the probabilities, it's still distribution over things that are in the subspace. So, okay. So basically, the whole thing boils down to the structure theorem, which I've written. I'm going to phrase now.
See somebody.
So I'm going to phrase it both in the version of it for pseudo distributions and the version of it for actual distributions. So structure theorem, this is the pseudo distribution, and one of the interesting things about this maybe algorithm, which I'm not sure, maybe we've already seen it, I'm not completely sure. Often, sometimes it's the case that you have results that are like super trivial for actual distributions, and the hard thing is to show that they extend for pseudo distribution. This is a case where this structure theorem is actually interesting for actual distributions as well. In fact, for actual distribution, it's a generalization of Lovett's result for the log one conjecture, which was like the first advance in this log one conjecture, like a more significant advance in 30 years or something like that. So it's the case that it's actually like a non-trivial. I don't think it's the only case like that, but it's one of those examples where the thing is non-trivial even for actual distributions, and in some sense the heart of the matter is proving it for actual distributions. Extending to pseudo distribution is not that much of a big of a deal. So when you think about this theorem, that you should pretend that it's an actual distribution, because that's really where the technical core and the creative core is. But let me start by stating it for actual distribution. For pseudo distributions, the way I would say it is the following. For every, there is some k, which is going to be O tilde of square root n. The O tilde things are going to basically include terms that are polylog in n and polynomial in 1 over epsilon. And so there is a k like that, such that for every k plus 2 pseudo distribution mu, there exists a polynomial p of degree at most k. This is just a normalization condition, such that mu prime, if we set mu prime, define it to be mu p. So we'll sometimes call this like a k round, okay, degree reweighing of mu, right? Because basically the way you think about it is you reweigh the probabilities. It's actually going to be an actual, it's going to be an SOS polynomial. So it is actually like a proper reweighing. So you reweigh the probabilities by p, and it's kind of clear. Maybe should have made it an exercise. Probably if I'd written it as lecture notes, I would have made it an exercise. Think of it as an exercise. Show that this mu prime is at least a degree 2 pseudo distribution, or whatever. In general, if you take a pseudo distribution, of degree L, you reweigh it by a polynomial of degree k, you're left with a pseudo distribution of degree at least L minus k. It's kind of an easy exercise, actually. So if we define mu prime as follows, then we get that expectation of mu prime v transpose minus v0 transpose is at most epsilon v0 transpose, when v0 is the expected vector. Okay, so this is exactly what we need, right? And I guess
how do you find p?
So we'll see the proof. And the proof will also give you, the proof will actually give you a way, it will be constructive in some sense, it will give you a way to find it. And of course, just to solve the distinguishing question, you could have, the algorithm could have stopped somehow in step one and say, if there is a pseudo distribution, output yes, if there isn't one, output no, and that would be enough, but we actually can find it. Typically, you kind of want to actually find it. So let me say, here is the version for actual distributions. Basically, what we would say is the following. Let me call this star. The way for actual distributions, what we would say is that, for every right, and but what is mu? Mu is, in this case, let's say mu is this some distribution over the unit sphere, like V such that V is 1. I mean, for this structure theorem, it doesn't care that these things are in W. That's not. It's a general theorem about any distribution over the unit sphere. You can always make it so that the expectation matrix is approximately rank one if you're willing to spend that square root n things. And for the actual distribution, the way you would say it is the following. For every distribution mu, again over the unit sphere, there exists a mu prime with k divergence mu prime mu at most k. So, that satisfies the same thing star. So for actual distributions, what seems to be natural is to us is to replace this condition that you reweigh by the Greek polynomial with the condition that you can reweigh the distribution. You know, it's an arbitrary distribution. You can reweigh the probabilities by anything you want, but you shouldn't. But on average, you shouldn't fudge the probabilities by a factor of at most 2 to the k, more than 2 to the k. Right. So k divergence. Did we talk about it already in this class? If it doesn't have to remind us, then you know, kernel divergence of mu prime mu is the expectation over mu prime of a log mu prime of v divided by log mu of v. So generally, the way you think about it. You take one probability distribution and now you reweigh its probabilities, make some of them larger, some of them smaller, as long as the average factor by which you change things is at most 2 to the k, then you have KL divergence. And sometimes you can also think about it in terms of entropy or information. Somehow you look at most k bits of information about every vector and use that to change the probabilities. So it's kind of the information between mu prime and mu is k bits. And this is kind of like what? So the degree of the polynomial in the k is the same thing. If you look at it in kind of the Bayesian framework, what you could say is that mu prime represents the result of learning k bits about the unknown solution. So you had so the distribution mu represented your uncertainty about the solution, and you went and asked for k bits, and now you know more, and now you can use that. Yes.
Sorry, wasn't KL divergence like log of proportion?
Ah, yeah, right. You're right. You're right. That actually makes more sense, right, for what I said. Right, log of the quotient. Right, so if on average you like the way you get mu prime is by on average you shift the probability by some at most 2 to the k, then you're good. And let me say you like the version, which is the version for flat distribution, which might be the easiest to think about and captures the heart of the matter. So the version for flat distribution is the following. If suppose that mu, it basically says the following. For every mu, now think of mu as a set. V1, Vn, some subset of the unit sphere. So there exists an I such that I is not too small, I is at least 2 to the minus k times n. So it's a subset of the indices, such that if you look at expectation of I in I, VI transpose, you know, it satisfies stuff.
Okay, so one version, like for, so think of U and U prime as flat distribution. They're just uniform over some set of vectors. So you can think of that basically mu is uniform over some set of capital N vectors, where capital N could be very, could be huge. And mu prime, the K divergence basically means that mu prime is a distribution of a set that has a fraction at least 2 to the minus K inside inside mu. Yes?
So in the second and third formulation, what is the dependence? What is the
take? It's the same, sorry.
So it's the same, it's always the same K.
K is O tilde of square root N, yes. So all the theorems basically say the same thing, and the way we would do it is, in some sense, we would kind of prove this version and then show how we'll think about this version, and our proof will kind of maybe get this version, and we'll show how it extends to this version. So, yes.
In the actual distribution, is it actually like a variance matrix for the random vector?
Yes.
It seems like you're saying almost like, give me this certain distribution and then I reweight it a bit, like the variance becomes very small, right?
The variance becomes roughly 1:1. So another way to say it is the thing says given, you know, arbitrary distribution on you know, the sphere of n minus one dimension, you can shift by O tilde of square root n in KL divergence. And get distribution so that the top eigenvalue of expectation V transpose square dominates the sum of I from 2 to n of you know, lambda I, the same. Okay, so this is another way to say it. So you can reweight things so that now, if you look at the variance matrix, the top eigenvalue somewhat dominates all the rest.
So isn't the variance matrix is the expectation deviation plus minus the other kind of?
Yes. Yeah, the V1 kind of like you could say the expectation. Yes. So
yes,
so you could say the variance is small. Yes. The variance is small compared to the expectation.
Okay. Is somehow key that you're only saying the variance is small compared to expectation, or just, I don't know, maybe it's just not intuitive. But you can start with sort of arbitrary distribution and then reweight it by a small amount, so the variance is very small. Does that mean like you killed a lot of entropy or something?
So in some sense, what you want to say, like one intuition could be that you kind of want to say that you have maybe kind of a win-win situation where you would say, okay, there are two kind of cases. One case is whether the original distribution was very concentrated on some, you know, small subset of direction, etc. Then I learn, you know, scroll 10 bits of information, I could completely fix it. The other case is maybe the distribution was completely uniform. Think of the distribution as being completely random, completely random vectors. Let's say, maybe that's actually like a good example to think about. So here is an example, and make the life very easy. Think that V, the original mu, is uniform over plus minus 1 over square root n to the n. Right, these are unit vectors. Think of V as being uniform over these things.
So what we'll do is now define mu prime to be the distribution where you basically fixed plus 1 over square root n plus 1 over square root n for the first, I don't know, 100 square root n coordinates, and the rest are fixed as before. Okay, so we have this uniform distribution. So mu prime, you only fix square root n coordinates. So think about it, you didn't fix a lot, right? You only fix very small part of this thing. But now what happens is that V0 in this case will basically be right plus 1 over square root n plus 1 over square root n, and the rest of the coordinates are 0. So the norm of V0 say squared is basically k over n, roughly I guess 100 over square root n, right? That's the norm of V0. And now what's the norm of the what's the rest? The rest is kind of the rest is basically this variance matrix of the remaining part. The remaining part, if you look at the expectation of like V prime transpose, then basically the way it will look is basically will be like the you know, this is essentially n coordinates. Right, so it basically will be like 1 over n times the identity. The covariance matrix C will be basically 1 over n times the identity. The one way to think about it, right, I mean, you can just compute it, right? The expectation of ij, if I and j is different from, is not the same, then the expectation is 0. And if I is equal to j, the expectation is 1 over n. So so and the norm of this thing is 1 over n squared, the norm squared of this thing. So by the norm squared of V prime squared is like 1 over n squared n times 1 over n squared, which is did I get this one? I typically get these things wrong. So did I? It's 1 over n squared times the identity thing, so times n. So the norm squared of this is 1 over n. So what it means is that the norm of this thing, the norm of V prime transpose is 1 over square root n. So you see that the norm of the variance is 1 over square root n, the norm of the V0 is 100 over square root n, V0 dominates. So this is kind of a good example to keep in mind. So this is also demonstrate what I said before. We actually fixed a very small part, we actually fixed a very small part of the coordinate space. So if you look at every individual vector, most of its mass comes from the part that we didn't fix. But overall, when we take expectation, this large part is going to be cancelled out. And basically, the structure theorem says that we can always do that. Okay, so I think that might be like a good point to take a break. So, but somehow, I hope that, you know, I'll give you an extra long break of like 10 full minutes. So I hope try to ponder this example, because in some sense, if you understand this example, you kind of understand what the structure theorem is all about. So make sure that you understand this example. If you don't, ask me questions after the break, and then we'll go on to proving it. So one way kind of if we kind of take a big picture of that is a little bit like this algorithm, you're kind of saying that ignorance is bliss to some extent, which is the following thing. Think of this mu as really kind of capturing your uncertainty about the actual distribution, and you basically say the following thing. You have two options, like
mu. It's either as, you know, it has like low entropy. And then basically you kind of fix, let's even imagine this kind of case situation where it's some distribution over plus minus one over square root n. And you basically it's gonna say, well, we're going to fix square root n coordinates, and it's going to be completely fixed. So then we are very happy. And the other case is that it has high entropy. And then we basically want to say we are going to use the structure of this problem, and that's kind of say if there is a high because this problem is really has this property that if you take VV transpose and you know that it's in the subspace, and you know V prime transpose is also in the subspace, and the linear combinations are also in the subspace, then you have this ability to average out all these solutions. So you kind of take a bad thing. Basically, the distribution mu having high entropy is a bad thing. It basically corresponds to your ignorance. It says that you have no idea where the solution is. And you take this bad thing and you turn it into a good thing. You say, okay, I can I have this huge uncertainty about the distribution. I pretend it's an actual distribution. I can average things out, get a different solution that's in the subspace. So it's somewhat weird, but nice thing that it works. Please, it seems to work. If you find a bug, please let me know. And the high entropy case, so it's typically the more challenging case. So typically, if you think about if you're trying to analyze an algorithm in this kind of subspace framework where you think you're kind of given this distribution that captures your uncertainty about the solution, you think of the high entropy case. And indeed, for example, for hard problems like 3-sat, that's basically the case where this Grigoriev distribution that we built was very like a very high entropy distribution, and it was basically we couldn't kind of get off the ground. Once we're given this distribution, we don't really know what to do it because it basically the problem has this structure where it can have this bunch of this huge number, exponential number of solutions, say solutions to a SAT equations. Or this solution to a 3XO equations, which have this, they're completely random, and we really don't know what to do with them. But here we have this problem has this nice structure that if we get two solutions, we can do something with them, like the average of them needs to be, also has this kind of structure, and that's something that's useful. So that was kind of the vague thing. Yes, Alex?
So is the high entropy case, are we actually going to be able to reduce it to a flat distribution case by just saying that like high entropy distributions are complex combinations of flat distributions over a large number of points?
So in the actual distribution case, essentially flat case, with whether low or high, you can always assume that things are flat. So in the actual distribution case, you can usually...
But there's no trouble passing to the flat distribution.
No, there's no really trouble. Like the heart of the matter is the flat distribution in either case. Yeah, and indeed, in the log rank setting, people always think of just flat distributions. So let me now kind of explain what this has to do with this law. Right. So indeed, I'm going to assume. So in some sense, especially when you're talking about, you can think of a distribution is always a flat distribution over a multiset, right? So that's almost basically without loss of generality, you can think of. So now we are going to talk about an actual distribution case. And we think that mu is uniform over V1 till V capital N, you know, a subset of this unit sphere. In little n dimensions. Now the point is really that capital N could be huge. As far as we can see, we can think of it as almost infinite. We have no control. I mean, in actual, because of epsilon net consideration, it's probably going to be at most exponential in little n, but But think of it as a completely huge number. And now basically our goal is, let's even think about our goal is to find some subset I of capital N such that if we define this matrix M, which is expectation over I in small I, and that is not too small, I is at least 2 to the minus O tilde square root N, little n capital N, so that this thing, if we define this matrix VI VI transpose, then we're going to get that lambda 1 of M squared is going to be bigger than the rest of the eight values. Dominate it in L to no. By the way, I should comment that the whole thing will generalize. And the square root, the reason for the square root n really comes from the dominating in 2 norm. And if you wanted to dominate in 5 norm, you could do it in n to the 1 over 5 or something like that. But we don't know how to use it at the moment, but it's possible that we could do that. But anyway, that was just a parenthetical remark. So this is what we want to do, okay? We want to find a subset of capital N that that satisfies this property, that the first eigenvalue will dominate the rest of them. And now, notice that this is scale 3. It doesn't really matter if you put your expectation or sum, right? So basically, we can think of this matrix, right? So this matrix M is the matrix, the way it looks like, it's the matrix, you can think of it, it's this matrix, right? V capital N, V1, V capital N. Right? And, but this matrix, M, has the same spectrum as the matrix, I don't know what to call it, let's call it M prime, which is the one where you do things in the other way around. You look at V1, V capital N, V1, V capital N. So now this is an N by N matrix, small n by small n matrix, this is a capital N by capital N matrix. But the beauty of linear algebra is that they have the same spectrum. Why do they have the same spectrum? The reason is that they look like, basically they involve the same vectors. And if you look at the rank of M prime, then the rank is only little n, right? So, you know, if two matrices have the same, kind of involve the same vectors, they have the same number of eigenvalues, surely the eigenvalues are going to be also the same, right? So, So that's basically proves it. So. Yes. So you can trust me on that. Yeah. I mean, it's actually not so hard to show that these things have the same. Yeah. If you want to be more serious, one way to, I mean, you could do calculations and show that they have the exact same eigenvalues. One reason why this works is the fact that this is a nice fact that trace of AB equals trace of BA, and this shows that basically these matrices have the same trace and also all the powers of the trace. And if you have the same trace and all the powers of the trace, you must have the same eigenvalue. So this.
So basically, we could ask. Yes.
We can just show this by similar value decomposition.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. I mean, there were like various ways to show the same thing. So, it's a basic fact of linear algebra. These are the same spectrum. So now let's look at the matrix M prime. Okay. This matrix M prime is an n by n matrix, where the point I and j, you have the dot product of vi, vj, right? And now what we are asking is to find a subset I, so capital I, so that this part, this part of the matrix, which will correspond to this thing. Okay, I guess I kind of used M for the thing that's here. Maybe I should call this. This is MI. So this is MI. This would be M prime I, right? The restriction of M prime to I. And so what we want is for this to be approximately rank one. So now we can now phrase our question is the following thing, given. Say an arbitrary rank n, little n matrix, can you find a submatrix of measure at least 2 to the minus o tilde square root n that has approximately rank 1? And in fact, for our applications, we are fine with the restricted case where it's not an arbitrary rank. Rank M matrix, but let's think of it as a symmetric where all the vectors have this roughly the same magnitude. It turns out that these things are not really important restrictions in this case. They do make like notation easier, so we'll fix with it. So basically, this is now our question. We want to find a submatrix that is approximately rank one. So this is basically where we start seeing a similarity to the log rank conjecture. So this is the log rank conjecture. It comes from a work of Lovas and Sachs, 80-something, don't remember. And the version, the way I'll state it, is from 90-something, 5, 8, say 7, just an approximation. The way I'll state it is from, like I said, work of Simon Biggerson, and if you want to see the original statement of the log rank conjecture in the communication complexity setting, then I think Mika Goose is going to give a lecture in the reading group today at 1:30, and I think he's going to talk also about the log rank conjecture. He's going to talk about the communication complexity setting. I'm not going to talk about it in the way it's originally phrased. I'm going to talk about it in the way that was shown equivalent by Nissan and Biggerson. And what they showed is the following. Here is the conjecture. For every m times n matrix m in, let's call it plus minus 1, plus minus 1 n squared, of rank little n, there exists some I, a subset of n, of size at least 2 to the minus polylog of little n capital N, such that m cap I is monochromatic. So basically what they said is you take an arbitrary matrix M, you can always find, which is Boolean and small rank, you can always find a small rectangle where everything is a plus ones, or maybe everything is plus a. And monochromatic is obviously also rank one, so we can make this rank one. It's also the other direction as well, because if you have a rank one rectangle, a rank one submatrix in a rank one submatrix which is Boolean, then you can restrict yourself to half the rows or half the columns, and you're going to get something that's monochromatic. So it's basically the same thing, the monochromatic or rank one. So I should say that the way it's typically phrased, M doesn't have to be symmetric. So I'm thinking of M as symmetric, and then and I'm thinking of I as the same guy here and here. The way they would phrase it is usually there is a subset I here and a subset J here. Doesn't really matter so much. Let's just ignore it for and look at this statement. So basically, the log rank conjecture seems kind of pretty relevant to what we're doing. It makes a stronger assumption. It makes a strong. It makes the assumption that the matrix is actually Boolean, and it gets a stronger conclusion, which is that the submatrix is exactly rank one. What we are looking for is relaxing the assumption, don't force the matrix to be Boolean, and get a relaxed conclusion, which is only approximately rank one. And because the log rank conjecture is not yet proven, what we hope is to use, so this is a conjecture. What is a theorem by Lovett is I, which is at least 2 to the minus O tilde of square root N capital N. So, and what we are using, we're basically going to use is the proof of Lovett's theorem, actually a version of the proof that's by Rotvoss, to get to show that the same proof, or it's actually not the same proof, like some extension of this proof can lead to the result that we are looking for. And I should mention that here's another kind of interesting open problem, is Gavinsky and Lovett show that this is also equivalent to something like 1 minus 1 over 8 n approximate rank 1. So basically, they basically show that you can, the log rank conjecture, it doesn't have to be exactly monochromatic or exactly rank 1, it's enough to be 1 over, you know, 1, I'm not sure, it's some constant. Some constant. It's enough that you like, you know, majority of you rank one up to like almost all of the entries, and in our setting we care about 1 minus epsilon, and whether the 1 minus epsilon version, what kind of implication does it have to communication complexity, is still open. And an interesting question. Yes?
There's a result that I've heard of, but I don't really know much about, where also by Lovett, it says that the approximate log rank conjecture implies the log rank conjecture. So, like, approximate. And yes. I wonder if this is relevant here.
Yeah, so I think somehow this is related, like, these things somehow related to this thing, but the notion of approximation. We're kind of interested in the notion of approximation that might be weaker than the one that they're looking at, but it's kind of I think it's still kind of not known exactly the relation. So basically, what we are going to do is uh, what we are going to do is going to go over so we're going to show how basically you can we're going to prove our statement, but basically following pretty closely their statement, and maybe I'll say a little bit about how their statement is proven. And to people that actually, I think, worked on the Lagrange conjecture, what we're doing is a little bit sacrilegious, because somehow, you know, dropping the plus minus one condition from the Lagrange conjecture is like, I don't know, like dropping the free trade from the platform of the Republican Party. It's like, it seems inherent to the problem. So I mean, the Lagrange conjecture, the way it's typically thought about is that it's all about Boolean matrices, and the idea is that if you want the Boolean matrix to be log rank, then really the only way you get it is by basically cobbling up kind of disjoint. The way we get a Boolean matrix to have small rank is by somehow kind of cobbling up kind of disjoint rectangles, and you cannot really enjoy cancellations and keep the matrix being Boolean. And somehow, some of what we show is that you can you get some statements. And that where you don't talk about Booleanity, and there are two ways to look at it. I think the half empty glass and the half full glass. So the half empty glass would say, you know, Lagrange conjecture is really about Booleanity, and if you manage to show that such a result from non-Boolean vectors, it means that the square root n thing is not really about that somehow the interesting regime of Lagrange conjecture starts beyond square root n, and that means that probably like it's a negative result about these techniques. They hold even for non-Boolean matrices, so obviously they are not relevant to the real Lagrange conjecture. And the half full empty glass is that maybe the Lagrange conjecture is a special case of a more general statement about Lagrange matrices in general, and there could be even stronger statements that would actually imply it and imply our result as well, and speculate at the very end what such statements might look like. Yes?
So, okay, given what you just said, you can't know the answer to this question, but do you think that there's any hope of proving your result just taking Lovett as a black box? Could you see any possible way of doing that?
So, yeah, not really, because like this plus minus, I mean, the plus minus one is a very strong assumption. So like taking it as a black box, typically you need to. So we need to kind of open the black box in two ways. First of all, we need the proof to be SOS. So, but even assuming that you had an SOS proof of the Lagrange statement, the fact that it assumes this Booleanity is like very something that doesn't hold in our case. So we kind of need to open it also in that way. And indeed, we're not even choosing, I mean, the proof is more complicated than the Lovett's proof. It's kind of, you can think of it as iterating Lovett's proof. So we'll see that.
What was proof, really, of Lovett's bound?
So just maybe before we kind of go into, so now our focus is going to be the proof the structure theorem. This in the actual distribution case. But before I do that, let's just think about the broader thing, which is like the algorithm, the way that the final algorithm looks like, which is somewhat strange if you think about it, right? So if you think about the final algorithm, then what it does is basically, you know, it dreams of this mu, right, doesn't really exist, this pseudo distribution mu, which, you know, over this huge set of vectors, it then builds, you know, the matrix that doesn't exist, like this huge pseudo matrix, imaginary matrix that where you had V1 till V capital N, V1, V1 capital N, and then basically finds like this rectangle inside this matrix, and you know, extracts solution. So the algorithm is kind of interesting, right? Because you kind of have this, you kind of really nudge it at the pseudo distribution, the actual distribution, and then there is an actual matrix, and you find the rectangle inside this matrix, and then now, after you found this kind of strange description, maybe you can find like a more direct description of the algorithm that doesn't involve any kind of dreaming, etc. But it is kind of a way to potentially discover. I mean, at least that's the way we kind of discover this algorithm, and it does show how thinking about things in this way could maybe allow you to think of algorithms that might not look natural if you think of them in other ways. So I think it kind of demonstrates this notion of pseudo distributions and pretending they are distributions and seeing where that leads you. Okay, so by now I think we have done 1, 2, 6, and now we are going to do 7, 8, and 9. So I think I can erase this plan. Wait, so right now what we want to do is basically prove the square root n statement. At least sketch the proof. And we are fine in our setting with we want to prove this statement, we are fine in their setting, we are fine with being, say, 99% rank one. We don't really need 99% monochromatic. So, this is what was proof of Lovett's bound. So let's assume that M is N by N. Mij is the Vi Vj in plus minus one, and let's scale things more similar to what we're used to, so scale it to one plus minus one over square root n, vi vj are in our n, and so and the claim is going to be that there exists some I with 2 to the minus O of square root N, capital N, such that maybe the way I'm going to write it is expectation over I J V I V J. Is going to be closer to the plus one thing. This is in I by N. Right,
so this is what we want to provide, that there is a nearly monochromatic vector delta. And step one, then you can assume that Vi, Vj, I think you can assume that it's at least, at most, like in our case, we assumed it's, they are unit vectors, but not Boolean. In the general case, it turns out you can assume that they are at most one or off one or something like that. It's something to do with the Jones ellipsoid or something like that. In our case, kind of this assumption is not even, we are of course not going to be able to assume Booleanity, but our vectors will be unit vectors, but it turns out that this is kind of without loss of generality. So let's even assume that they are exactly one for simplicity. You know, all the vectors, the V1 to Vn. And then, what we're going to do is we're going to pick G to be say a Gaussian in N0. One over n d. So we're going to pick a Gaussian, a random Gaussian. So what does it mean? It means that, you know, if g is g one to g small n, then g I is a random Gaussian with variance one over n, and with variance one over n, and with mean zero, and we are going to define I to be little I such that Vi G is at least n to the 1/4 standard deviations. 10 n to the, I don't know, 100 n to the 1/4 standard deviations. Okay, so this is going to, the probability that your n to the 1/4 standard deviations is like 2 to the minus square root n, right? If you're picking a Gaussian. So let's just, the size of I is going to be roughly, you know, 2 to the minus of square root n capital N. Now let's just figure what the standard deviation is. So the standard deviation, right, so the variance expectation of Vi Gi squared is going to be 1 over n Vi squared. Right, so Vi G is going to be distributed like a normal with a norm of V squared over N, so which is normal of 0, 1 over N. So this basically standard deviation is 1 over square root n, so this is basically I such that Vi G is at least, I guess, 100 over n to the 1/4. Did I get this right? So now we're going to look at now we want to look at expectation over I
and J.
Okay, so now we want to look at basically, okay, so now I think what we want to look is the following thing. Suppose I, what's the difference, suppose Vi, suppose Vi Vj is equal to minus 1 over, 1 over, minus 1 over square root n, versus Vi Vj equals to plus 1 over square root n. Now we want to understand what, in what case, what's the probability that both I and J are in, and what's the probability that both I and J are in I in this case. Okay, so we want to compute, so what we hope is that basically when we do this thing, we, if I, Vi Vj, say, had, let's assume things were balanced before, because otherwise, it was nearly it was already nearly monochromatic to begin with. So, but, so suppose it was like half-half before. And now what we want to say is that if Vi and Vj are the positive dot product, then they are much more likely to be now together in I than if they had negative dot product. And therefore, now the set I is going to be very imbalanced. So, so because of the way Gaussian work with the rotation invariants, it's actually not so hard to do it, right? So we can write Vi, we will write it the following, we'll write they have some, so if Vi Vj is like plus 1 over square root n, we can write them as there is some V, we can write Vi as some just W plus W prime, and Vj as W plus W double prime, where the W the W primes are the orthogonal part, and Vi Vj is equal to the norm of W squared times you know, if it's plus, then yeah, it's in a plus direction. So the W, the norm of W squared is the norm of W squared is, in this case, 1 over square root n. Right, did I get it right? This is the direction which they agree on. This is the direction, there is some direction which they are the same, and then there is the direction that is orthogonal, and the direction and that direction kind of contributes, right? So kind of by rotating, you can say, you know, they agree on the first coordinate, and they are kind of orthogonal in the upper coordinates, and that's what happens. And now, right, and if it was minus, then this will be W, and this will be minus W. Okay? So, so basically, if we can, if we pick this random Gaussian, so now we are analyzing for a fixed Vi and Vj, and we pick in a random Gaussian. So we can think of it as we pick the random Gaussian in the W direction, and we pick pick it then in the, you know, the orthogonal direction. And the orthogonal direction, everything is going to be okay. So basically, when we pick it in the W direction, then we get, so what we are going to get is Vig is going to be Viw plus, sorry, Wg plus V prime, G prime,
Okay, so so maybe call it G0. G0 will be the part of G in the direction of W, and VJ WG0 plus this thing. So now we said this part is going to be so I think I'm just making things too complicated. So let me try to see if I can okay. So. So basically, okay. So maybe the way I should think about it, okay. So we just want to look at the probability that you have G VI is at least this value, 100 n to the 1/4, and the probability that G VI is at least G VJ is at least 100 n to the 1/4. So you can basically write it. It's going to be basically the same as the probability that G VI plus VJ is going to be at least 200 n to the 1/4. And now basically there are two cases here. In the two different cases, now this is a vector that if these guys have a plus direction is just longer than the case when this guy has a minus direction. So this probability is basically like it's going to be like 2 to the minus right, so this probability is going to be 2 to the minus 100 square root n, right? We kind of set it up this way. But now we're going to multiply it by 1 plus minus 1 over square root n, depending on whether VI and VJ have a plus direction or a minus direction. So we can see that there is going to be like 2 to the 100 multiplicative difference between these two probabilities. Okay, so let me, I think I made a little bit of mess of that, but so let me kind of write down, calculations are always bad for me, but let me write down like this thing. Okay, so this is going to be, okay, the probability that I and j are in I, the baseline probability for this is 2 to the minus some constant times square root n. This is the baseline, right? The constant is really the probability that one of them is in this is 2 to the minus c over 2 times square root n, and the probability of both of them, the baseline is like the square of the probability that, so this is kind of the baseline. But when these two guys are positive in a product, the probability is going to be a little bit bigger than the product of the probabilities. When the two guys are negative in a product, the probability is going to be a little bit smaller. What is a little bit? A little bit will basically be in the exponent. It's basically going to depend on the length of this vector, VI plus VJ. In the case where they have positive in a product, it's going to be something like 1 plus 1 over square root n longer, and in the case, so this is going to be basically like 1 plus 1 over square root n, and this is going to be 1 minus 1 over square root n. So the point is that this is going to be about 2 to the c times bigger here, this probability than, this probability, the signs wrong, plus minus. So this probability is going to be about 2 to the c times bigger here, it's always. I think it was better. It was correct before.
This when the vector is longer, this is actually an event that's more likely to happen. When the vector is longer, this is an event that's more likely to happen. So the point is basically, when the vector is longer by a factor, multiplicative factor of 1 plus 1 over square root n, the event is going to happen with a constant factor more probability. So this is a very different. There's a very small difference in the norms between the vector vi plus vj in case 1 and case 2. But because this goes into the exponent, we multiply by square root n, this becomes a noticeable difference. And you can see why the square root n exponent comes into play. Okay? This is, by the way, the way this is sometimes called, this general method, if you search for it, it's called dependent random choice. It's kind of, it's a method that's been used in many cases in combinatorics. I think, if I remember correctly, I think Jacob Fox gave recently a talk at the IES about that. I didn't see the talk, but I think the video is online. It might be worthwhile to look at it. So the idea is that why is it dependent random choice? Because we kind of choose this random, Gaussian, and now the choice of whether to include every individual little I in the set I is depending on this random Gaussian. So individually, every vector has the same probability of belonging to the set I. But the correlation between two vectors that are positive in a product are more likely to fall together in that set than two vectors that are negative in a product. And that's what makes the final set be monochromatic. Yes?
So I know you said that we should worry about the SOS part of this, but yes. Do you have any like intuition for why in the world it should be SOSable when you're doing it by like probabilistic method?
Ah. Okay, yes, so I can say it's now a little bit, yes, so basically what we are really doing, one way to think about the probabilistic method is, what we're really doing is we are selecting a G at random, that's okay. We are not doing a union bound. What we're really doing is we re-weigh Vi by e to the by something like I think what comes out to be like e to the n to the 1/4 vi g or maybe even like maybe even I need to make this. Let's make this, let me write this G, to make this into a standard normal, I need to multiply this by square root n. So this is kind of, this is now a standard one normal viable, right? And now we are reweighing, vi by e to the n to the 1/4, these things. So we could also phrase these things as rather than the conditioning, then the reweighing. And now we could do a Taylor approximation of this function. So we get a polynomial. It's a randomized polynomial, but that's okay. So we're going to analyze the expectation of the reweighing polynomial, and then it will be a SOS. So I think maybe we can do a break now, and you can. If I made a mess of these calculations, maybe you can use the time during the break to try to figure them out yourself, because it's not that complicated. It's not that complicated. So basically, this I claim that we have. Give you one more minute, so I'll say one more thing. I claim that basically this has proven.
So you can complete the proof in the, if you didn't believe me, you can complete the proof during the break. So this has proven the, this statement that we are going to get. We are going to get when we average over the choice of G, there is going to be at least one choice of this G that give, will give us a subspace that has this much size, and when you know 99% of the things are going to be are going to be plus one, and then basically based on that, so that gives us basically Lovets bound. It turns out that like approximate is good enough for them. And what I'm going to do after the break is show what we do in our case. And in our case, we have to do something a little bit more complicated, and we'll talk about it. So now our goal is, we kind of have the same assumption, except that we don't assume that it's Boolean, right? It's we have a matrix, so maybe before saying the goal, what is the setup? So now we have our case. So we are given this matrix M, where Mij is Vi, Vj, and you know this V1, V capital N are unit in Rn, little n. And now we don't know anything about the dot product. We don't know that they are plus minus 1 over square root n. And our goal is to find some I in n of I, which is at least 2 to the minus O tilde of square root n, such that m restricted to I lambda 1 of this is going to be much larger than the rest, lambda I. Okay? So, and we know that we can also, MII is the same spectrum as so as expectation over I in I VI VI transpose. So we can also phrase our goal in this way. So let's start by seeing what happens. Let's assume this is also say without loss of generality that the original case the same thing is that VI VI transpose is this is the assumption that originally the vectors are in isotropic position. You can always kind of transform vectors to have in an isotropic position, so without changing the matrix M, so let's say this is basically fine. Can even transform them while keeping keeping them unit. That's something known as Foster's theorem. That's kind of a parenthetical statement implied by the Bascom-Lieb inequalities. But let's this is really all more an assumption for we're going to drop this assumption soon, just for the sake of illustration. So we have these vectors, and we want to make them approximately rank one. And the idea is, we're going to do the same thing that Rothfuss did. Okay, so we're going to choose G at random in n 0 1 over n I b. And we are going to define I to be the set I such that G GVI is at least this big, right? 100
over and to the one at the bottom.
Where 100 is some constant that we make as large as possible, it could even be polylogging. So, right, so we define the set I, and now we want to understand what's the, so let's start to start by understanding what's lambda, what's going to be lambda one, what's going to be the top eigenvalue of this matrix, and one way to lower it, bound it, let's look at G transpose expectation I in I, VI, VI transpose G. So that, by definition, is going to be at least 100 over n to the 1 quarter. Sorry, at least 100 over square root n, right? So we're going to create this eigenvalue, which is 100 over square root n. And if we didn't touch the others, right? So if for some so we know that basically lambda one of MII is going to be at least 100 over square root n. By the way, of course, when you do this kind of calculation, you always have to divide by the norm of G squared. But the way we chose G, its norm squared is very, very likely to be 1. Right? So it's very concentrated, so this is really the eigenvalue, the top. So this is the lower bound of the top eigenvalue. So the top eigenvalue is going to be at least 100 over square root n. And now, if the rest of the eigenvalues, so originally the sum of squares of the eigenvalues, originally the matrix had this, it had looked like this, 1 over n, 1 over n. What's the sum of squares of n, you know, of these guys? Right, n times 1 over n squared is 1 over n, it's getting late, I see. I don't know how you guys are going to survive like Mika Goose lecture, like it's not like, you know, there's another 3-hour lecture. And I was thinking that Friday is maybe a little sparse, and we should like add another 3-hour seminar maybe. So originally the sum of the lambda i's was 1 over n. Now we have gone and made sum of the lambda I squared was 1 over n. So you know, let's look at it. So before, we're actually having this, it's the inverse of what you usually have, like with before and after picture. Before, you had this guy that is very skinny, sum of the lambda i's squared is 1 over n, right? That's the isotropic. And after, you have this beer belly, like lambda 1 is sum of, right? Lambda 1 squared is larger than 1 over n, right? It's like 100 over n or something like that. Now, if that's the only place, so we made it fat here, if that's the only place where we made this guy fat, we are very happy, right? We are done. This matrix is approximately rank one. But you know, this is an arbitrary distribution. We have no control over this distribution. It could be very well be that we suddenly, you know, we try to do that, but we suddenly create this thing. So, you know, it's just, I don't know if it's your guys' generation. I was reading this book to my son yesterday, Flat Stanley, where this kid is flat and his brother is putting a bicycle pump into him and trying to pump him up. So this is very similar. So you know, we hit this thing, we hit the, so the good case is that we kind of, we put this Gaussian, and somehow we only got one eigenvalue out of it, and we didn't get the others. But maybe we increase the others. But usually the kind of thing we do in TCS is we say, okay, we've done something like that, we have made progress. And in particular, if
this thing happened and we, so if we moved from, let's look at the total Frobenius norm squared. So originally before it was 1 over n, and now the total Frobenius norm squared is like now 100 over n at least. And we have made progress. We, if this happens, we couldn't repeat it more than log n times if this kind of repeatedly happens. So the thing is, we say, okay, if only lambda 1 squared, if lambda 1 squared dominates the Frobenius norm of the rest, we declare victory and go home. Otherwise, what we're going to do is, intuitively, this is what we're going to do. What we're going to basically now choose now a new Gaussian, G prime, which is going to be from the normal distribution, but now it's going to be from the normal distribution, but with the new so it's going to be from the normal distribution, but based on the based on the isotropic, but based on the not the isotropic, based on the moment matrix of a new distribution. So that's more the general thing we are going to do. So rather, so in fact, this is what we did before. I just didn't say that, right? We chose G from this distribution. This was really the expectation of VI transpose, and more generally, we're going to choose G based on the moment matrix that's going to match up the moment matrix of a distribution. So okay, so if you've not seen this generally before, when you select G from n, n 0 and some PSD matrix M, what it really means is that, say, in the eigenbasis, say, if you think of M as, you know, lambda 1 to lambda n, in the eigenbasis, you basically select gi from n 0 lambda I, and which means that expectation of gi squared is lambda I. In particular, the expectation of the norm of g squared is going to be the trace of m. In our case, it's going to be 1, right? The distribution is always, if it's expectation of VI transpose over unit vectors, the trace is always 1. And now, if you want to understand what is going to be, so now we want to understand what's going to be what's going to be, say, VI G squared, say, expectation of VG squared. So that's going to be, let's write it in the eigenbasis. So that's going to be, by the way, we're going to think of it as, right, this is a normal variable and 0, and we want to understand what's the variance of it. So it's going to be sum over kind of vi squared gi squared, which is going to be sum over lambda I. The gi squared will give lambda I, and an expectation, expectation vi squared in the eigenbasis is going to be also lambda I. So this is going to be, the variance of this is going to be the Frobenius norm of m squared. So basically, on average, for a typical v from this distribution, vg is going to be like a normal with 0 and the Frobenius norm squared for the variance. So what we are going to define the set I is going to be I such that Vig is at least, I don't know, 100 n to the 1/4 standard deviation. Standard deviations is like the Frobenius norm. So that will give us a set of the right kind of size. And now we want to do the same analysis. So we're going to look at, so we define, you know, mi to be expectation over I in I, vi, vi transpose. And we're going to look at, say, g transpose g transpose mi g. And we know that this is going to be at least 100 square root n Frobenius norm squared. So and the way we are going to say this is going to be at least, because the Frobenius norm is always at least one, is always at least 1/√n, then this is going to be at least 100 times the Frobenius norm. So we get that lambda 1 of the nu m squared, lambda 1 of the nu m is larger than 100 times the Frobenius norm of the old n. So in particular, the contribution lambda 1 squared, so the contribution of lambda 1 squared is already, so basically you see that if you're not completely done in some sense, that then you're increasing the Frobenius norm. So that's basically the outline of the proof for actual distributions. And
so everyone increase by a constant factor.
Yes. Yeah, so you only need like log n factor, log n bounds. But I did hear.
Why the Frobenius norm?
What?
The Frobenius norm of the magnitude. We know that the first eigenvalue is increasing, right?
Yes. So the increase in the first eigenvalue already. So basically, what we know is the following thing. So let's look at the bad case, right? So originally, the Frobenius norm squared was 1/n. So this was step zero, okay? Step zero. Now step one is that lambda one squared, let's say it is like 100/n, but we either done, or the reason we are not done is that the rest of the thing, like the Frobenius norm, is like, you know, 200/n or something like that. You get like, this is not the reason for all the Frobenius norm, there is still some left. So now in step two, we are going to basically do this trick, and now we are going to get even better eigenvalue. Now we're going to get lambda squared is going to be like, you know, this 200/n. But the reason we are not done is because maybe this Frobenius norm is now, or you know, it's going to be say 400/n, and this will be like also 400/n. Let's say this is going to be 200, this is going to be 400. So in the step two, we have increased, because what we see is that basically, if the original matrix was not isotropic, we get more. This is basically what this argument says. We didn't get merely, before we only said that lambda 1, the new lambda 1, will be at least 100/n. Now we say
you know, if the Frobenius norm is better than 1 over square root n, we get better than, better lambda 1. So, so as long as the Frobenius norm is large, we can get like a better lambda 1. And we cannot repeat this more than log n times. So basically this is the kind of argument we do in the actual distribution, as you'd say, that if you actually go and look at the paper, then the things are a little bit more complicated there. And basically the main idea, I mean the idea is, the general idea is kind of the same, but the you have to be a little bit more careful. And so there are two main ideas that some are two main tools that are useful also, I think, in general in SOS that I want to say, so I want to mention them. So one is this thing that I kind of glossed under the table before, which is this thing. I kind of said, that VG will be like norm of will be like normal with this thing, which kind of assume that every vector VI is kind of typical in the sense of it's kind of typical. And the things might behave non-typically. So there is a general kind of statement we want to do, and there are kind of two steps that we want to do. Actually, even for actual distributions, if you want to make this thing into an actual proof, and definitely also for pseudo distribution, and there is one is like fix scalar quantities. And the other is a fix vector quantities. And the general, let's just remember what's kind of the rule of the game. We have a distribution, and we want to restrict it to an event that happens with probability roughly 2 to the minus square root n, and where things, nice things happen. So restricting to events that happen that happen with probability 1 over poly log n, that's kind of free for us. But this is like 2 to the minus log n, or that's kind of free for us. We can always kind of assume if we don't, you know, if we don't like the distribution right now, we can condition on some event, as long as the event happens with probability at least, you know, at least 1 over poly log n, 1 over poly n. That's kind of for free. That's not something we worry about. So in particular, that's something that's useful when, suppose you have a distribution mu you know, over V, and you have some F, like a scalar F. So F, you know, from Rn to R, where, so F from Rn to R, and you want to say and suppose you know that say expectation of how do you want to say it? Suppose that expectation of F is at least let's say f is in I don't know 0 some n,
or polygon and expectation. So let's say f is in 0n, so we can ensure, so in actual distributions we can ensure f is in some interval, right, is in some interval a, and a to the 1 over plus minus 1 over poly n. Let's see. Yes, like we can show this with probability 1. Right, we can split this kind of we can split this interval, say from 0 to n, to a polynomial number of intervals, and restrict attention to one of the intervals will contain at least 1 over poly n of the mass, and we can restrict attention to, we can condition on being inside this interval. Okay, so that's something we can do in actual distribution. We can ensure that the probability is 1. When we talk about pseudo distribution, we kind of never can really condition, so we can never really get something that has a probability 1. If you're strictly, you know, if you're really pedantic, you can say that we can never talk about probabilities in an actual pseudo distribution, but let's not get carried away. but the way you think about it in pseudo distribution, you cannot ensure that you get probability 1. So in actual distribution, you can ensure that in O log n cost, right? So in pseudo distribution, what you would get is you can basically assume this, you can basically get probability 1 minus 2 to the minus k, or something that we used 1 minus 2 to the minus t in basically O of t log n cost. So in some sense, you can never get exactly fixed quantities completely, but you can have the effect, including the effect that you could basically do union bounds, etc., of doing something of fixing this with probability 1 minus 2 to the minus t. Now what does it mean actually to fix for pseudo distribution? So basically, what do we say when we want to fix a pseudo distribution? The statement you would want to prove is that the expectation of f of v, say minus a to the t is smaller than, so you suppose you want to fix up to accuracy epsilon, you would want to think t as an even number. This expectation is at most say epsilon a to the t. So this basically says that, right, so this is an expectation statement that we can at least write for pseudo distributions. And basically the kind of statement you want to say that there is always a conditioning of a pseudo distribution that will ensure this statement. And the way we interpret this statement is that, you know, that probability that f of v minus a is larger than 2 epsilon a is less than, you know, 2 to the minus 2. Right. So this is basically what you. So this is how you kind of translate. So the typical way you want to translate results from actual distribution to pseudo distribution is you want to first make sure that all the manipulations that you want to do to actual distributions only involve reweighing with polynomials, and already when you do that, you have to deal with this fact that you cannot ensure that things happen with probability 1. You have to happen only with probability 2, 1 minus 2 to the minus t. And a lot of the complications happen at that point. And then you want to make sure that everything you're using the analysis is basically SOS and that. So one of the steps, if you go and look at the proof, is we need to fix scalar quantities, and when we fix, we want to fix scalar quantities to make sure that they don't go too wildly. You know, so for example, you have like these vectors, so you and then what happens is that you don't want to fix too many of these scalar quantities. So you don't really look at, so we kind of don't look at, we can't really afford to fix, you know, the projection of VI in every one of individual directions. So we kind of look at rather than looking at every individual eigenvector, we kind of look at higher dimensional eigenspaces. So the if you look at the proof, the way it looks in the paper, what you would have the general state the general statement would be the following thing. Look at the matrix M expectation vi suppose, and you think of it in the right eigenbasis, it's lambda 1, lambda n. Then, first of all, here is an easy kind of claim. The first, say, 10 square root n eigenvalues contribute. So the first 10 square root n eigenvalues contribute how do you want to say it? So you want to say that maybe lambda 1 plus lambda 10 square root n squared is larger than let's say is larger than at least as large as let's say at least half of from I to 1 and lambda I squared. And So the first, if you look at the first, if you looked at the first 10 square root and eigenvalues, then you know just because they definitely contribute more than every other block of square root n, at least as much as every other block of square root n, then you can show that this thing is true. So that's just a calculation. And what it kind of means is that if you manage to take these, so what it means is the following thing. Like look at this, distribution in the first square root n coordinates, or 10 square root n coordinates. If you manage to fix this thing into a single vector, then you would basically take all the mass that was on this subspace and you collapse it to a single direction. So in the new matrix, the new eigenvalue will be the sum of these eigenvalues. This makes sense? So think about it, what does it mean when you fix, when you take a distribution, let's say, so you have a distribution, say V, which has some mass on some subspace, capital V. So basically, expectation of V V transpose the trace of this is like the norm of maybe the way I would say the following thing. The trace of expectation of V, V transpose in the first, like the, you take the trace of the, like the first some L directions, is like the expectation of the projection, the norm of the projection of V squared into this first L direction. So and if you manage to fix this projection that so that it's always the same vector, then you're basically taking all this mass and you're making it into and you're moving it into the first into one single eigenvalue. So this is in some sense what we want to do, right? We want to take one eigenvalue that will dominate the Frobenius norm. And the way we do it is we want to look at the way we're going to do it is we're going to look at the first square root n eigenspace, and we want to fix the distribution inside that eigenspace, and then basically it will move all the mass, it will kind of collapse all this mass into one eigenvector. So it will make one, the new eigenvector will have the value which is the sum of these eigenvalues. So the first thing we'll do is we'll fix, so we find this we look at the matrix, we look at the eigenspace, we do our fixing scalar to fix the total norm that is in this eigenspace. So we can assume that this thing is concentrated, that the projection of the vector to the first 10 square root n coordinates is fixed. And now what we want to do is we want to fix the vector inside the subspace. So fixing a vector inside the subspace, just morally speaking, if you have a subspace of dimension L and you want to fix a vector in it, you should be able to do it using L rounds of degree L. Right? This is kind of like think of it again as an invasion thing. If you have L coordinates, you can ask L questions about these L coordinates. You lose L rounds of that, or degree L, or total minus L probability, however you want to do it. So basically, you have to prove a lemma like that. And you would kind of imagine that the people in the SOS world have already proven it, but somehow they didn't prove it with the right parameters. So we basically prove something like the following. Okay, so if mu is an actual distribution, say over, and now think of it as like RD, so think of it as what's going on in some D dimension, then, okay, so then this is kind of an epsilon net argument, right? We can find mu prime where the divergence of mu prime to mu is say d over epsilon or something like that, and such that and some vector v zero, such that with probability one over mu prime over v from mu prime, the norm of V minus V zero is at most epsilon. Let's say if it's unit vector. Right, this we can do by some kind of an epsilon net argument. Right, you partition, you take an epsilon net, you take the guy in the epsilon net that's most likely, and you can do that. So basically, we get a version of that for actual distributions. We basically says for pseudo distribution. So basically says if mu is a pseudo distribution over RD unit vectors, then what we want to say is that you get, can reweigh with, I think we get like D over epsilon, like O of D over epsilon, something like that, such that the new distribution will have something like 1 minus epsilon weight here, and the rest. So and the rest could be elsewhere. So you get like some V0. So you get some V0 such that V expectation V0 V squared, the unit V0 is at least 1 minus epsilon. Yes?
So instead of, sorry, this has sort of popped up randomly, but instead of talking about changing by some polynomial, saying by some polynomial, can you just like talk about an approximate KL divergence of pseudo distributions by taking a Taylor expansion? Just like taking the normal definition of KL divergence and doing some Taylor expansion or something like that?
I think it might be possible. I don't think anyone has done it, but I think it might be possible. My hope is that this part about moving to polynomials seems a little bit mechanical. One could hope that you could do something like that. Yeah, so basically, one way to say that, but basically what you want to say is that, if you were willing to spend like D over epsilon time in dimension D, you could dominate. You could really completely fix things, and completely fix things would be that basically it would be the analog to this kind of thing. It's basically you're going to dominate in the trace norm rather than just dominating the Frobenius norm. So in some sense, what you want to say is that you find this subspace of the square root n dimensions, and you fix that thing, which kind of says. That subspace you dominate in trace norm, and then that means that you kind of dominate the entire thing in Frobenius norm. But you might have created some new large eigenvalues because you did that, and then you have to repeat it. But you're not going to need to repeat it too many times. And now let me just end by saying, okay, so this. I think the way I stated the structure theorem, it's tight. Like you cannot do the example I studied in the beginning, just random plus minus one vectors shows that it's tight. But there is a very interesting to me, like there are several directions how you could potentially try to get beyond it. And let me give you one direction, which we haven't really had time to think about a lot. So maybe one of you guys can find like an easy counter example. So let me state it as a conjecture, but I don't know if it's really a conjecture, but so let me write this as a conjecture. So suppose that V1, Vn, this is mu. Uniform over this thing, again like unit in Rn, then there exist a negative, potentially negative reweighing function f. So what does it mean? What do I mean potentially negative reweighing function f? So it means of f such that expectation over mu of f of v, say the absolute value is 1, and expectation over mu of log f of v mu of v, little of 1, maybe start with even. This would be interesting n to the 1/3, such that if we define that basically expectation of f v v v transpose is roughly 1:1. So there is some non-zero v zero. So basically, could we get more power by reweighing with negative coefficients? And why would we hope to get something like that? So because let's think of this plus minus. Let's think of this plus minus one example. And And okay, let me even say something like, okay, maybe not even one, let's say L, and L is rank of one or something like that. So the idea would be the following thing, like in the Gaussian example, we knew that square root n, that in square root n things, in square root n time you cannot really dominate in the Frobenius norm. But you can, suppose you, what would happen if you reweigh with only n to the 1/3? So when you reweigh with only n to the 1/3, then so you basically can do, you can get some distribution that looks like V0, V0 transpose plus 1 over n id, like in the plus minus 1 case, where the norm V0 squared is now 1 over n, V0 squared is like now 1 over n to the 2/3. So the Frobenius norm of V0, V0 transpose Frobenius norm squared, which is like V0 to the 4, is like 1 over n to the 4/3. So this is very small, this is small, this is small compared to the Frobenius, this doesn't dominate in the Frobenius norm, right? But suppose we did it twice. So we have one reweighing, mu1, that gives us mu0, and this gives us this, and then we have another reweighing with also n to the one, to the third round, that gives us v1 transpose plus. Now we can subtract the two. And now we get basically rank two matrix. So we get a rank two matrix, and now if we think of our original application, then we'll get something that's still like super interesting, like a rank two matrix that is inside our subspace W. Right, so you could, so for our reweighing, it would be kind of super interesting, I think, to get like expectation. You get that expectation mu1 v transpose minus expectation mu0 v transpose. This will be a matrix that is in W and will be roughly rank two. So if this conjecture is true and you get and it's true for pseudo distributions, you could get like a basically very interesting rounding algorithm here. And in fact, some version of it might be also useful for the log rank conjecture, because also for the log rank conjecture, if you find like a rank two submatrix, then you can find a monochromatic matrix of like measure 1/4 or something like that. Like, so it's not. So basically, also for the log rank conjecture, again, like the almost might be like an issue here. So, but basically, so if you allow negative reweighing, I don't know of a good counterexample. I'd be interested in that. Maybe there is one. Maybe I mean there might be some obvious counterexample. Might be some way to improve things. So that's basically an open question on how you would improve things further. It's hard for me right now to say how hard or easy it is, because we really haven't spend a lot of time to think about it. So maybe there's just a simple counter example we're just missing, or, you
know. So, I mean, if
we
want to achieve rank two, is it easier than rank one?
In some sense, yeah. Or, like, every one matrix is in particular also rank two.
And we allow negative weighing is also easier.
Yes.
Why is the problem become harder?
No, I want n to the 1/3. Yes. So the question is whether this gives me the power, right? So the question is whether this thing gives me enough power to get beyond square root n. Because I kind of know that if I want, the rank two thing is not so important. Like I think if I want beyond square root n, if I restrict myself to positive reweighing, even if I wanted rank five, it wouldn't matter. Like we cannot do that. And I think for positive reweighing also it might not make a difference rank five and rank one, because could always just spend like an extra constant number of rounds and fix yourself in that subspace. But the question is whether negative rewiring can allow you to break this code end. And I don't know the answer, so that's... Okay.
So, yes. Ah, sorry, I went 5 minutes over time.